Okay, hello everyone. Today we have Dr. Tanzila with us today. Dr. Tanzila, thank you so much for being with us today. Can you please briefly introduce yourself?
Hi, thank you so much, Javed. I am Tanzila. I am working as a postdoc in UCSF, University of California, San Francisco. I did my PhD in neurobiology in Switzerland. I think we'll come to all that in the course of this conversation today. And I was born in Kashmir and now I'm based in San Francisco. So let's keep it precise for now.
Yeah. You always planned to be a scientist, because I was looking at your CV. It was like, was it something you always wanted to do, or was it just one day you decided like, I want to be a scientist?
So I think it depends on, so I have a very hardcore idea and perception about like being in science and research. For me, it's an obsession. You know, I grew up as a child, as you know, I'm very inquisitive by nature, actually. So I grew up like that. I always wanted to be in research. I always wanted to look at the molecular level of things. So pehle se hi, I was like, I wanted to be in this field. I wanted to do research. I'm not saying that other professions are not great or something, but then I'm just saying that I always knew that when my parents at one point when I was young were pushing me to do medicine, I knew that even if I studied medicine, I would later study genetics or something else, you know, something more to do with research. So it was like from the beginning, I am inquisitive by nature. I ask a lot of questions. I think I'm also very talkative. So, this has been like a dream. So I think for other people, I don't really know. So, you know, for me, it's been like that. So I have been interested in research from the beginning. Some people decide later. Sometimes it just comes to them later in life. For me, I'm like, it's a passion. I always knew it's something like that.
When did you start preparing for your PhD? And how did you, because doing PhD in Switzerland is really hard. So how did you start the process? When did you realize that you really wanted to go outside India? Like, take us through the journey.
So it didn't really start with the PhD, of course. So I did my undergrad in Bangalore, so in Mount Carmel College. I mean, it's one of the reputed colleges there. So one good thing is that you first of all go to good names, because that's what matters as well. So you need a good tag with your name. So, you know, you don't want to go to some random college and people don't know about it. So Mounts was a good college. And then, you know, you get good education. That is important. I mean, you're not going to college and not studying there. So I actually used all the opportunities. I was good at academics. I mean, I tried to do a lot of extracurricular activities. But before even I went to college, I mean, during my school life as well. So until 10th, I was in Kashmir. So every year I used to be a part of a lot of co-curricular activities. So I'll tell you why I'm coming to all this, and because it actually builds your CV. So my parents wanted me to first of all, become a doctor when I was young.
Like every other Kashmiri parent.
Of course, and I think engineering was for my brother, or then sometime they wanted him to become a doctor. So it was like, you know, we both did not become doctors, but then anyway, that's not the point. The point is that when I was a child, I knew already that I had to maintain a good record. Somehow I was always a planner, because you know, when you grow in a conflict zone, you have very limited resources. So you need to kind of outperform your peers. So I think I was like that. So I don't think that there was any guidance from anybody at home as well, because my parents let me be that way. So I was kind of self-guided and, you know, a lone star running around. So I was doing well in academics as well as in sports. So all those things mattered. So when I went to college, basketball, throwball, you name it, I played it. I was a school captain in class 10th and also in 12th. So and I was better in sports than in academics, and I was still the topper. So you can imagine that. I liked sports more than academics. So it's amazing. Okay, anyway. And I was, so now that I think of it, there's a joke. So I was actually in the cultural club in school and not in the science club. So I was like singing and dancing, which is weird. I was like, this is shocking. But this is really funny. But anyway, so because... I mean, what I'm trying to say for youngsters as well, it's not where you start. It's like wherever you are right now and you have not done anything yet, this is the time you have to start. If you're in class 8, you're in 5, start building your CV. Because it depends in the end, you know, you have a lot of extracurricular activities. You have to show that you have done so much additional to your academics. Because in Kashmir, we may not get so many avenues. Like, you know, outside people have so many competitions, essay competition, writing competition, they have international competitions. And in Kashmir, we don't have so many opportunities. But whatever opportunities you have, why will you let go of that? Because that gives you a certificate. That gives you something that you can add to your CV. So I did that. I built a very strong CV. And when I was in my undergrad, I mean, of course, I was good in studies. In undergrad, I did not participate in any sports. So when I was good in studies, I was awarded a Goldman Sachs Global Leadership Program. I mean, this was a program. I was awarded an award that year, in second year of my college. And there are like many other students, like 29 or 30 students got it all over India. So it's a very prestigious award. And I was the only one from my college who got it. And when I went to that, you know, it was like a leadership workshop and it was held in Mumbai. When I saw people from other colleges, and they're like from National Law School and IITs and all, I found that people are extremely bright. And, you know, somewhere I realized that people in my college were not the real competition. Like the world out there is actually very bright and people are brilliant. So it's not just about competition. It's like you have friends. Now I have contacts who are like, you look up to them and you say that, wow, guys, you guys are doing amazingly well. And all of them actually went to Oxford, you know, Harvard, and you know, all these people have gone to all these Ivy League schools. And you look at them and you're like, wow, like, you know, all these people are very, very bright. So you started there. I got the Goldman Sachs Global Award, a leadership award. And when that was done in my undergrad, the CV was strong. There were so many certificates. Apart from that, even in my undergrad, I was in NCC. So I was, imagine I'm assembling a rifle in Manekshaw Parade Ground in Bangalore. I mean, you know, when I think of it, I mean, it was a proud moment that time, because for me, coming from a background, I know how we feel. And then I was doing it because, you know, we had to get credits. But at the same time, I liked it. I like the idea of, you know, doing something as a team, as a group. So it was fun. For Saturdays, I used to go. I made friends. You know, I went for different camps. I went for, there was a hospital attachment training camp, and I went there as an attachment. I worked in one of the hospitals in the cancer ward. So, you know, it was an eye-opening experience that you actually tend to patients who are terminally ill. So there's so many aspects of it. So when you're actually going through and you can get so many experiences, because you have to understand that Bangalore is very cosmopolitan. So people in my college were also from so many different states, and they were bright people. And I was the topper there as well. So you have to outcompete those people, you know, and it doesn't matter in the end, you know, when you have to apply for fellowships. So if I told my dad that, okay, after my undergrad, I want to do a master's in England, I mean, definitely my father would be like, England is super expensive. He's not going to pay for that. So what are my only options? To get a fellowship. And I needed a strong CV, because now I had seen who will be the people in Goldman Sachs I'll be competing with for fellowships. So I knew what I wanted to do. So all these things, like, you know, essay competitions, inter-college competitions, singing competitions, I was doing everything that came my way. And I was trying to get something. Yeah.
Yeah, students in Kashmir, unfortunately, we know they don't get a lot of opportunities, particularly at college level or university level. Do you have any advice or any suggestions what they should do? But living in Kashmir, like things they could actually do in Kashmir, because we know that a lot of these things cannot be done in Kashmir, like something that they could do that will help make their CV better than their competition.
See, I think I have seen many students actually who write a lot of articles in newspapers, and they actually, see, when I was in school until 10th, I mean, where did I win best in debate and something competitions? University of Kashmir used to organize these symposiums. So these people can do that. If they are in University of Kashmir, they are in colleges, they can organize all these things, because this is not only helping them in team building, they are actually helping in this as well. You know, try to get their teachers on board. Try to get, these are the things they have to push their teachers as well, that we need to organize this, we need to do poster competition, we need to do this symposia, we need to do exhibitions, we need to learn more, we need to read. If we read a book, like, you know, come together as 10 people group, read a book, read two chapters, discuss it, clear your basics. I mean, tomorrow when you go for an interview, you will be asked those questions and you would have covered that, right? So
be more proactive.
be proactive. I mean, why are you sitting at home and not contributing? Somehow everything matters. If you read two lines, with respect to not reading those two lines, it's like you have not basically learned if you have not read them, right? So it's like that. You have to be progressive and proactive yourself, especially in our case. Because see, I don't want to say this, but you have to understand that being in a conflict, we have limited resources, but it also plays in our favor sometimes. I mean, I shouldn't say this, but it plays in our favor because many people know we are from a conflict and we have limited resources. But that doesn't mean we will not do anything. That means we make the best use of whatever little we have. Yeah.
So how did you apply to your PhD program and get the fellowship? Was it a competition? Did you need to...
I did my master's in England. I was, I'm a Chevening fellow, actually. So I did, I was telling them, I don't know why I got lost in everything. So when you have a good CV, I got the Chevening fellowship, basically, in my master's. So I went to England for my master's. And there I did my dissertation with my professor. I was in University of Sheffield. I did my master's in stem cell and regenerative medicine. And he moved his lab to Switzerland. So when you go to some place and you work hard, it gets noticed. So my boss realized that, oh, actually it's better to hire somebody who's a known demon than someone who's like an unknown person. So he told me that he could actually offer me a position if he had something. And when, so he didn't have anything available instantly. And after England, I went back to Bangalore. I was working in Institute of Stem Cell Biology. It's called INSTEM. And regenerative medicine. And then I applied for another fellowship, a Swiss Government Excellence Scholarship. So it is for Switzerland. So basically what students need is they need to find a host university and a host professor who can give them a letter, for example, of support. So they need to tell the professor that, see, it's a three-year fellowship, so I want to work with you. And they, I want to write a project. So sometimes professors will help you see through your project and see what you have written. You don't want to write about, the professor is working on biology and you're writing about the universe. I mean, that's not how it's going to work. You need to write about what the professor is working, something relevant, so that he finds it interesting as well. In the end, you may not work on that project because the projects always, they evolve while you go. So you apply for that because Indian students are eligible, actually. So we are basically eligible as well to apply for this fellowship. So you can apply for Swiss Government Excellence Scholarship. All you need is you have to proactively look for a host lab in Switzerland. And they may not pay you as much as a Swiss PhD student, but it's good enough that you can survive in Switzerland.
And
there's no tuition, no? Switzerland, I mean, it's a very nominal fee. I mean, there's not much. Per semester, it's very little money.
Tell us a little bit about your research. What are you working on? But in a very simple word, something everyone can understand. You don't want to get technical there.
No, I'm working on simple stuff. I don't work on anything technical. I think if it's technical, then I wouldn't be working on it. I wouldn't understand it myself. So I work on stem cell biology. So I'm a neurobiologist. Basically, I work on the brain. So during my PhD, we tried to understand that the cortex, the cerebral cortex, how it develops over time. So, and I worked on mice. So basically what happens is it's a sheet of cells in the neural tube. So let's say it's a sheet of cells and we are trying to understand how this neuroepithelial sheet of cells develops into a three-dimensional structure of the brain, the cortex, which is a six-layered structure. And these six layers have different types of neurons. They have different functions. They make different connections. So how these, this layer of cells, which has the neural stem cells, how do these cells know that what type of neuronal layer to give rise to during development? So I'm a developmental biologist by training. So this is what I worked on during my PhD. And so we looked at basically the expression, like the RNA expression, maybe students who are going to basically, I don't know whether you're from biology background, maybe no.
No.
Other students will understand a little bit more. So we looked at the transcriptomics, basically the RNA expression of neural stem cells in particular, how they change over time. And then we looked at neural stem cells give rise to other type of cells, which are called as progenitor cells, basal progenitor cells. Then we looked at the RNA expression of those cells, and then those cells basically differentiate into newborn neurons. So we looked at how the newborn neurons are changing over time. And yeah, I mean, so on and so forth. So basically, we were trying to profile the different populations in the mouse brain during embryogenesis. Simple. That's what
it is. That was really simple. Yeah, everything. That was easy. I should apply it. I don't know why I didn't.
You should. You should.
We all, like, we come from Kashmir, we understand the kind of society we live in, where girls, unfortunately, there are certain challenges that they face. Did you ever face these kind of challenges? And how did you convince your parents to, you know, you're going to England, you're going to study there, then the PhD, we're talking about years of studying in a foreign country. Was it hard to convince your parents, or were they understanding, you got a fellowship, and they were like, she's talented, we should just let her be?
It's so many questions. I mean, it's very funny. Who said I have convinced them?
I'm just saying, I mean, did you have
it? It's like, I'm more on the run. It's like, I took my bag and I'm off. I'm like, bye. I left like that. No, it's not true. I mean, my dad, after a certain point, he wanted me to do, I think it was because of Shah Faisal, that everyone wanted everyone else to become Shah Faisal. So my dad also wanted me to do IAS. After my undergrad, maybe I would have done it if I was an average student, honestly, because if I was somebody who was just getting 75-80%, but then my aggregate is like 90-95%, like, you know, in college. So I was like, I'm not going to do something and give up on my subject. I'm doing extremely well. And if I was in any other subject, like, you know, if I was into civil services as well, I know I have the aptitude because I know I'm hardworking. But I would be, no disrespect to civil services, I would be a very unhappy person for the rest of my life. Because I don't see that spark that I see, like, you know, in research. I told you it was a lifelong goal for me to, like, you know, I'm inquisitive. I mean, imagine an IAS officer being inquisitive. I mean, that's not something.
Get fired, yeah. First day, yeah.
I'll be like, maybe they will not even just recruit me. They'll be like, no, you're fine. So, yeah. So, and I told my dad, if I join IAS, I will opt for IPS because I'll be an angry person. So he got scared, but no, they were actually eventually never convinced. I think fellowships helped. They were really pushing me not to do masters and basically do IAS as well, coaching for IAS. And he was okay with me, like, basically being in Delhi for a while and studying for IAS exams. They were very, I mean, my mom, I would say, was convinced. My dad, I don't know, I think Kashmiri fathers, or maybe my dad is like that, you know, they will never consider you're talented. Even I don't think I'm talented, but I don't think my dad will ever say that loudly, that, you know, okay, you've done well or something. So even during my PhD, when my experiment sometimes didn't work and I called home and I said that this is not working, the answer came, I told you to do IAS. So I'm in Switzerland, I'm living in a very nice country. My dad is like, why didn't you do IAS? So, you know, that was the answer. So it was, I was like, come on, like, you know. So somehow, I think, you know, parents do that also because they are protective of you. So, you know, they wanted me to get settled very soon. And if you are in research, you can't get settled. I mean, the kind of, like, you know, work I do, for example, you don't get time to basically take a break. So when are you going to get settled? And I'm not at one place. I'm not in one country. You have to keep traveling. I would say my mom was understanding. My dad, possibly he's trying to now value that what I'm doing, and now he's okay. I think he's come around, I think, overall. But I think society-wise, I do still feel that we face challenges. For example, I still get told things that, now it's enough, a woman should only do a PhD and not study anymore. I mean, I was told this and I was actually shocked. Because I'm sorry, I mean, did you pay for my education? No. Why are you telling me that? So we are an excessively patriarchal society. And I don't know why, but then people have to change that mindset. I know it's going to be slow. And how I survived all this is because I'm a rebel. Like a little mushy rebel, but I am a rebel. I mean, I don't care. And if I need something, I just go ahead and do it. So I think people have to basically develop this attitude themselves.
Do you feel women face challenges in academics or research?
Oh, absolutely. Because women have a different biology. I mean, we all have biological clocks, but women also have like an additional pressure of, like, you know, like procreating. Basically, we have to have a child or children, you know. And when you are in academics, when you are in academia and you have to like publish and then you are evaluated with your male co-workers at the same time. I mean, when are you going to take a break and have children and then go on maternity leave and, you know, work on stuff? So you always take a backseat. That's why we see that not many women actually are in the top positions in academia. I mean, there are right now, numbers are growing, but then it's not as many as we see men. That's because many women have to actually take a break or they have to give up on, you know, their research for a while. And then when they come back, maybe they're not able to settle in the same position or they have to take a position lower than what they actually deserve because they have taken a break. So it is difficult. It is not easy.
If a student has to do a PhD, what time do you suggest that he starts preparing for it? Is it in school, undergrad, master's? Like, what would you advise them? And are there any resources that they could check out to help them, to basically could guide them?
So if they are in school, start now. If they are in master's, you're late, start now. If you are in bachelor's, start now. I mean, you're still late. But then that's what I'm saying. So it's not about, so when you're applying abroad, first of all, they will see your CV as well. If you are applying for fellowships, I'm talking about if I look at my own journey. I mean, what mattered is when I sent in my achieving fellowship application, I sent them copies of 70 certificates because I had so many, because I did so many things. And possibly I did not send everything. I mean, I couriered them like, you know, 70 of them, which I had on me in college. In Bangalore, because I sent the application from Bangalore. The idea is that to do maximum things, because you also grow as a person. So for me, I was not that I played one basketball game and then I'm done for the rest of my life. I played basketball like, you know, every year. For 6 years, I was playing basketball continuously. So it's like that, you know, you remain consistent. You will actually be good at things. Make a strong CV whenever you are. So basically, people have to contribute differently. If you are in your school, you make a good CV from the beginning. Focus on your subjects. You have to be good at everything you're doing, especially in academics. You have to really outperform. If you're driven by research, okay, there will be people who will have basically different opinions on this. I'm not the kind of person who thinks that I will wake up one day and say that, okay, I will do research. For me, there has to be a drive. Because what if tomorrow, you know, today I think I'm doing research. Tomorrow I'll be like, it's not interesting anymore. For me, the drive has to be there from the beginning. And, you know, for me, it's important. Like the drive, that passion has to be there. I told you, research for me is an obsession. So people should really understand that. And when you love something so much, you are definitely going to find ways to, like, you know, do things. So there are groups like Other Scientists Have Made on Facebook. We have some senior scientists, Mubarak, and, you know, they have made this JK Scientist group. And there are people who are connected, like scientists, JK scientists from all over the world. If there are youngsters who want to read something outside their own curriculum, we can share like a review article, you know, like a background of something. Bachelor students, master's students, we can always send them papers to read. We can tell them, read this, read that. So they can start, you know, I told you about basics, because if they are also doing internships in India or they are doing some short projects in India, in ICERS or, you know, other institutes in India, going to NCBS or, you know, CCMB, one of the, like, you know, these premier institutes in India, they will have to go through interviews. And they're hardcore interviews because students come from all over India and they are really difficult interviews. I mean, I have not even sat through those interviews myself. My friends tell me they are really hardcore. So you need the basics to be clear. I'm pretty sure my basics are not that clear as well. So you need to read, you need to hone your skills, yeah.
How important are publishing papers and internships?
Internships?
Because in Kashmir, unfortunately, we don't have the concept of internships. I mean, papers are low with them, but unfortunately, we don't do internships. So it's just a cycle that keeps on repeating. So how important are internships and writing research papers?
Internships are very important, I would say, because it's not just about that you get a letter written that you have done an internship. It's also about the skill set you learn. If you're doing an internship, you learn some skill that, you know, I mean, this internship, for example, even in the US, you see people in the lab here, even bachelor students come here. Sometimes high school students come here. I mean, in Switzerland, we had high school students coming to the lab. because they are getting a feel of how things are working in the lab. The same way, Kashmiri students can come there as well to go to the labs, or, you know, maybe try to do internships. If people are doing internships, you know, be honest to that and learn things, learn extra things, tag along with the student and try to learn what that person is doing. Just offer help if there's a PhD student. Even if you are not going to get anything, you're not getting paid. I know that sometimes internships are not paid, but there is a skill set you might want to learn. Even if you are watching, even if you learn a technique, because that's how I learned. I watched people do stuff. And then you learn, because that's an experience.
Internships are very important. Unfortunately, students in our part of the world don't do it.
It's important if you have a paper, but you know, when you're applying, for example, for a PhD or fellowships or something, and then you're comparing, somebody has a paper and you don't have a paper, of course, then, you know, they will evaluate that, oh, this person already has a publication. So you are in a competition with somebody else who has a publication. But then people also know that if you are at a young stage, I mean, people are reasonable. Okay, you are a bachelor's or a master's, they don't expect you to have a publication. But even if you have a publication, it's a very small impact factor, they will still be happy that, oh, this person actually has a publication. Like, you know, even if this person is from a university that nobody has heard of, for example, in Germany, somebody hasn't heard of some university back there in India, they will still be like, oh, this person has still done something, you know, has written a review article, or has done something else, has attended these many conferences, has done this particular course online, or has done that course, you know, somewhere else in some other university. It all matters.
We talked a lot about what kind of students should do PhD. Tell me, which students should not do PhD? Because in our part of the world, people just do degrees because society demands it, or someone's like, kuch karne ko hai nahi, let's just do PhD. What kind of students should not do PhD?
I think students should ask themselves, first of all, that if they really want to do something, when they do a degree, I mean, when I did my degrees, I knew that what was my plan. So I wanted to plan something, then I did something. I mean, you never do. It's kind of funny what people do back home. Sorry, I don't want to kind of mock it or something. I know we have a lot of societal pressure there. That is one thing as well, that, you know, there is so much of insecurity, jealousy, so much going on in our society, unfortunately. If you're not passionate about anything, it's not just with PhD. If you're not passionate about something, don't do it, because you will end up being an unhappy person. Why would you want to do something? I mean, yeah, if you need it and, you know, this is your bread and butter and you have to earn, then I understand. But if you're doing it because of societal pressure and to make a point to the society, that is a foolish excuse. Sorry, I can't take that.
Basically, do whatever your heart wants to do.
Do whatever that makes you happy in the end. Because don't do something that, you know, the Padoswali auntie wants you to do or expect you to do, because then you will not be happy and the Padoswali auntie wouldn't even be thinking about you.
That's a life lesson, very important life lesson. So yeah. You went from Bangalore to England. Did you face any cultural challenges or academic challenges? And how did you navigate those?
Cultural challenges, no, I'm very flexible that way. I mean, no, not at all. Culturally, like, I'm very dynamic myself, so I don't care. I'm like, you know, I kind of just get adjusted in the group. So I think academic challenge, I think it was just not me, but I think overall, all the students who came from India in England, I was in University of Sheffield, because Sheffield has a very good department of biomedical science. Okay, again, I didn't just go and woke up and, okay, I'm going to University of Sheffield because I can't go to Cambridge or Oxford. It's not like that. I didn't apply for Cambridge or Oxford because I didn't have money and I didn't have a credit card to apply and pay for their application forms. I was applying and nobody knew I was applying. Yeah, so I didn't have a credit card. So I applied for applications, basically for universities, which were free. And then again, let me just go to any Tom, Dick and Harry University. No, I went to the British Council in Bangalore. I checked their ratings that which university is the best. Then I found Sheffield, Leicester, you know, some of these universities had the top-notch departments. And Sheffield has a top-notch department in biomedical science. And then I went to Sheffield and I actually applied for the courses, which were top-notch. So stem cell biology, stem cell and regenerative medicine, molecular and cellular basis of human disease. So a bunch of courses from Sheffield. And wherever I applied, I got through. But I'm just giving you an example that you don't just go and find something that is like convenient and apply. You are going to pay a lot. I mean, I didn't pay my fellowship aid, but somebody was paying and you value that. I valued that Chevening paid for my fellowship. But then I wanted them to invest in a university that was very good. I didn't go for Cambridge. First of all, I didn't have application fee money. Second, Cambridge, I checked the ratings. The course there that was best in Cambridge was biochemistry. And my, you know, bachelor's level thinking was, if I want to study biochemistry, I will go to JNU. Why will I go to Cambridge? You know, I want to study something unique that is top-notch. And stem cell biology was really kind of growing, you know, and I was like, I want to do something unique. So that's how I did that. So what was your question again? Sorry, I missed that.
Yeah, my question was, you're facing academic challenges.
Yes, so this I want to tell you. Because when Indian students went there, so our master's courses used to be with bachelor's courses in Sheffield. So basically bachelor's students were with us. And we are never exposed to any papers in our undergrad. We were never exposed. So basically in our education system, they never tell us to study from any papers. I don't know if things have changed. Back then, we are given notes, or we are given like Xerox from like these two chapters from this particular book, or study Kubi, or study this book, that book, you know. So we were never given any like papers to read. So when we went there, it was a shock academically, because there were papers to read and I had never read a research paper. I mean, I knew nothing. So all the Indian students, even me, we did very bad in our classes, and we weren't able to follow so many things, because, you know, imagine you are just studying about Krebs cycle, and you know those things are important as well. I mean, we live because of them. But then you're like signaling pathways, and you're like, somebody just dropped a bomb at you. I mean, you're like, I have never heard of these things. So that's what happens. So there, it is a challenge. So it's better if you don't want to be like culturally, not culturally, but academically shocked. Get used to that reading articles, or get used to reading reviews from the beginning, because I was a college topper, and if I was totally clean bowled because of that, anybody can be. And all of us did very bad, actually. And then our professors told us categorically that Indian students who come here, they are not able to do so well initially, because, you know, they have never possibly read the papers. And it's true. It's absolutely true.
Yeah. How did you manage it? Did you take any proactive steps? Like, what did you do to excel in academics after that, once you realize that you're
struggling? It's English at the end of the day. I mean, you can understand. It's hard work. You just read it and you kind of get used to it. The point is, I mean, I worked very hard in my lab as well. It's not that, yeah. So I used to work a lot. England is difficult as well, because it's only 1 year master's. So you have to do your dissertation, the project, in 1 year. Basically, you have only 10 or 11 months. So I worked hard. We had many subjects. It's 180 credits. So it was many things. But then, of course, it was an enriching experience as well. It was the first time I went abroad on my own. It was fun, I would say. It was nice exploring. After 2-3 days of travel, I was like, oh my God, I'm in England. I'm on my own. I don't have anybody around. I know. If anything happens, what am I going to do? And I have been out since then. I mean, it's my 10th year since England. And I think I've been out of Kashmir for 15 years now. So that's a long time, yeah.
Yeah. So what happens in Kashmir, the Kashmir University, is that the result, unfortunately, it takes 4-5 months. Sometimes it takes 6 months. So a student has nothing to do for all those times. Like, do you advise them to do anything? Like, when you don't have classes, you don't have any work, what should they do to make most of the time? Because once they graduate, after that, it's going to be hard. So what should they do during that time?
That's weird. Why don't they go? I mean, not because of COVID. Okay, because of COVID,
everything is restricted. Yeah.
Why don't they do internships if they are waiting for 4 months?
In Srinagar, or they can even go outside.
Anywhere you find something, just go outside. I mean, sorry, I know not every family can send their kids outside, but many people can. And if you can't send your kids outside, for example, in Srinagar, find opportunities. And honestly, I feel that it comes down to the people also in Kashmir University, then professors and all. So maybe they should also think of something like, you know, some courses for these youngsters that we should kind of think postdocs, and like, you know, they should kind of make courses for these, or these youngsters should go to the departments and say that, can you make these courses for us? You know, even if we are able to pay some, you know, 500 rupees or 200 rupees per person, or, you know, just show us demonstration. Not everybody has to do it. Like, you know, show us something. I mean, I am somebody who wants to do something, never sit idle at home. I am someone who has never, touch wood, I have never taken a break. You don't have to take a break. I think this was possibly after my PhD, sitting at home and doing COVID times. I think this is the break I have taken. Otherwise, I wasn't even taken a break. So basically, this is the deal. So if you are getting, you know, if your results, your exams are done, your results are not out, go do something, read. If you're not able to get any fellowship, internships or anything, write on JK Scientist, contact us. Just, we will send you some review articles. Yeah. You know,
that's a very good advice.
Discuss a review article, have five friends, don't gossip about this and that. Discuss a review article. Hey, I read this page, or read a paper, you know, set up a Zoom call. Okay, Zoom call is also difficult, but okay. Social distance each other and just sit in a big angan or wherever, and then discuss a paper. You know, this is what I mean. So discuss with each other.
Tell us a little more about your postdoc and how did you get it? Did you apply it, or did you know someone in the lab?
So I basically applied for a fellowship, actually, and I have a fellowship for my postdoc as well. So it's called Early Postdoc Mobility Fellowship. Basically, it's a Swiss National Science Foundation fellowship. So I am in San Francisco because I'm in a very big lab here. The professor here is working on something similar. So we work on brain development as well. And his lab has produced basically amazing work with this, like, you know, in this particular field. So he's one of the top guys in our field. So I met him in a conference, and actually once we were talking over coffee, some friends back in Switzerland, and I was just joking with a friend, and I was like, hey, who should I go for a postdoc? You know, whose lab should I go to? Who's the best guy in the field? And she said, go to this guy's lab. Okay. So he's the only guy I applied to. And he was kind enough to take me, actually. So I met him in a conference. I kind of stalked him. I was like bumped into him. And I was like, I want to do a postdoc with you. And he was, I think, scared of me. And he was like, okay. I was like, ah, okay. So, yeah. So again, yeah.
That's one really important topic I want to talk about is networking. Unfortunately, again, students in Kashmir are not taught how to network. So would you suggest them any ways they could network? Probably make a LinkedIn profile or just reach out to people via Facebook or emails? Like, how should they network?
First of all, my example of stalking my PI is not networking. It's a very bad example. Yeah, I was not networking.
Don't do that because I scared him.
I did not network with him. I'll tell you what I did. I emailed him. I saw that this guy was coming to a conference with me, in the same conference, basically. He was going to present. So I wrote to him that I was going to be at a conference and I'm presenting a poster. If he would be kind enough to come to my poster, I would like to discuss
before the conference. Yeah. So you reached out.
Six months before the conference, I wrote to him that there's going to be a conference. I see you as a speaker. I would like you to basically come and see my poster. Okay. This is how. So I was surprised that he replied back, and I was like, you know, touched that he's very kind, actually. So touch wood, he's very kind. So I've been very lucky, actually, in terms of my bosses. They have all been very nice and kind, and I've always learned a lot from them. They're very nice mentors. So I met him. The conference was in California. It was in the Olympic Valley, actually. And we all had very bad experience because the East Coast weather was really very bad. So everyone had a story to tell. So it was like a journey from hell for me, because I came from Switzerland, was stuck for 2 days in New York, and, you know, I couldn't come here. So it was really bad. So everyone in the conference had a story to tell. It was a big conference, big shots. So when I reached, I had missed his talk. And I saw him in the, like, you know, that's why I was like, I wanted to oppose Darwin, because I was frustrated. I was like, somehow I've managed to come here, Like I was in Reno for a night and, you know, we were stuck there again. So at every step we got stuck in that. But I was resilient. And I think that is what is important. So I was like, jana hi hai. Like, you know, because there was someone, I was like, no matter what happens, I'm going to meet this guy. I was like, what is holding me back? So I have to go. So it was like this. So I met him and I told him, but this is what I did. Basically, I had emailed him before. Then right before the conference, I emailed him again, replied on the same email saying that, hey, I had contacted you. I'm working on this, this, and this. I would like to get your input on my poster. So see, I was confident that I wrote to him because there was something on my poster to show. If I have not worked hard, if I have not put in effort, if there's nothing to show, I won't be basically calling a big shot of my field, come to my poster, right? I know that he's not going to take me. So you have to put in that effort. So every time you need to put in hard work, that's what is needed. So when this person came to me, professor came to me, he saw the poster and he saw there was a lot going on in the poster. It was not only one project because I worked on a lot during my PhD. And he was very impressed with my work. And he offered me a postdoctoral position right there after I presented my poster. But I was like, I want to get my own fellowship. Because, you know, when you have your own fellowship, you have the flexibility of the start date. And when you are flexible, you want to have enough time in your previous lab to finish your previous papers. So the own funding also gives you a little bit of a flexibility. So if, for example, you don't have your own funding, your professor can tell you, okay, come in March and this is when you start. And your previous lab, your paper is important. You want to finish if that's not published because I still have papers going on there. So now it's ongoing, but you know, one of them is out. Unfortunately, the other ones are still not out yet. But then the deal is that then you're stuck, right? Because you can't leave those papers, but you have to move. So that funding sometimes really helps you because it gives you that flexibility. Yeah. So reach out to people like this, politely, kindly, not stalking them.
At the end, do you have any advice for students? Like three things you would like to tell them?
For all students, one, you need to work hard because hard work is most important. For research, if you want to be in research, or for that matter, for any subject, you need to be very passionate about things. That, you know, you need to have that drive to do things. Find your niche. Find your happiness, you know. Don't do something that you're expected to do. Be it your parents. You know, in the end, you will be happy for 1 year. Maybe your parents told you to become an engineer. You might be happy in the end. You might not be happy later because, you know, it's not what your dream is. So follow your own dreams. I think there are many things, more than three things. Third thing that's most important for me that has helped me always is resilience. And that is very, very important also, especially for women. I mean, we give up too soon because of patriarchy, our mindset. I am ridiculed time and again for my mindset because they think I'm too open-minded. I challenge society. But it's not true. If you want to excel in life, you have to be a little bit of a rebel.
Yeah. Do you have any particular advice for Kashmiri girls about how they can handle the patriarchy, dismantle the patriarchy?
I think we can all contribute. And it's not only, first of all, stand your ground, you know. I mean, don't give in, don't give up. I mean, honestly, I have seen patriarchy throughout my life as well. And I mean, of course, we give more importance, like, or I would say that, you know, I would say patriarchy and being protective in Kashmir, they go hand in hand. So our families are protective for us. And that's why, you know, it also comes in the way of patriarchy. But in Kashmir, we have another problem. Women contribute to that patriarchy as well. So they are also like, you know, be it our mothers, they're also like, you know, a part of aunties in the neighborhood. Like they're also kind of, you know, feeding into that patriarchy. First of all, women in Kashmir should realize that they should stop doing that because we have to stand by the side of our young daughters and women, you know, in society. That's important. So I think you have to stand your ground if you want to follow a dream, because parents have to understand a girl's financial independence, a girl's, you know, happiness is paramount. Okay, I understand that wedding is important, you know, a marriage is important, and then later family is important. But all this, she gets one life, each of us, you know, all of us get one life. So we have to make it count. We have to make it a full-fledged, happy package. We don't have to focus on one aspect while we ignore everything else. So girls also have to understand that they have to hold their ground and be confident, and only then it's going to work.
Thank you so much, Dr. Tanzila. I'm sure students will find this session useful. Thank you so much for being here.
Hope so. It was lovely talking to you. Bye.